Shalom, greetings to all and all. Selamta, Inest Ling. This is Ras Alonso Tafar reporting for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society of His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, and His Christ Jesus, HaMashiach, Yeshua. For the record, this day is Sunday, May 28th, and 2017, and it is 11:35 a.m. Now the following work that we are to present, we do or we bring forth on the basis that to do what we can is to do what we must. If ones can perform it better, then by all means, feel free to do so. Now, a few key points, disclaimers, not really, but you know, something of that nature. The following text that we are to read, we must make mention that the names in Amharic, the Amharic names, the pronunciation of them cannot be assured that we will do it as accurately as it would have been possible if the names would have been provided for in the Amharic text or in the Amharic language. That is, we do not know the vowel system, the pointing on the vowel system that is utilized, which includes the English alphabet. And so we are sure that the pronunciation of Amharic names will not be precise and exact. So let this be a warning to the listener. And to continue, we make mention that we are not professional readers. As a matter of fact, we did not begin to read up until the age of possibly 25, and we are now 30, and that is because we were called to Rastafari. We were called to Christ in light of Rastafari. Until that time, we had no interest in reading. To add to this, we learned to speak and speak mostly Spanish our whole lives to this very day. Therefore, you know, if ones could do it better, by all means, bring it forth. And I just do what we can, and that is to do what we must. Chapter 35, We Proclaim Mobilization. In all the civilized world, if one state seeks to wage war against another, it announces its intentions of doing so. After such an announcement has been made, the diplomatic representatives of the two sides return to their home countries. If their citizens so desire, they may also leave. But Italy continued making announcements that she had no intention of making war, while in fact she had long meant to wage war against Ethiopia, and for the past 3 years had decided upon it and had begun preparations. However, at some time, when the occasion arises, revelations are bound to occur. And so General De Bono has now spoken of it in the book which he has published about the war. And since this has been confirmed by Monsieur Mussolini's signature, it is not possible to claim that it is a lie. When we heard of the dispatch by Italy of war materials and large numbers of soldiers to her colonies of Eritrea and Somaliland, up to the realization of the timetable she had fixed to start the war, we made inquiries through our charge d'affaires at Rome. A reply was then issued which no one can accept as true, i.e., that it was as a safeguard against a surprise attack the emperor might be launching against their colonies, and that there was no other reason. Since this was allegedly the reason, we made it known by radio to Italy and to the whole world that we on our part were not thinking of a scheme of this kind. Although we made this announcement, Italy did not interrupt the dispatch of military equipment and troops. There were no factories to produce war materials in our country in order to make preparations on our part. We did not have enough money to make purchases abroad. When we asked for loans, Italy's resolve to make war being well known, we did not find anyone who would lend to us. Furthermore, since Ethiopia and Italy had signed with approval what is laid down in the covenant of the League, which the nations of the world had set up at Geneva, it seemed to us that if any kind of dispute arose between us, the matter was to be looked into by the League in accordance with the covenant, with a view to being settled peacefully. Over and above this, if a dispute that arose between the two governments could not be settled by diplomatic negotiations on the basis of Articles 5 and 7 of the Treaty of Friendship, which the two governments specifically concluded on 21st Hamle 1920, that is 28th July 1928, then the matter was to be disposed of by arbitrators. But in any event, there was to be no war between them for at least 20 years. Italy had claimed to be one of the great civilized nations, and it therefore seemed to us that she would not violate the covenant of the League. Moreover, by virtue of the fact that we did not suspect that Italy would start a war without notifying her decision to engage in hostilities, as the heathen of olden times used to do, we had not proclaimed mobilization from the moment of the Wawal attack on 26 Hedar, that is 5th December 1934, until 22nd Meskaram, 3rd October 1935, when she began the war with her attack on Adwa. But the Italians were well aware of the disposition of our troops in remote places and in the fringe areas of the country, as we entertained some suspicion that they might await the rainy season when no one would be able to march on the roads and then launch an attack. We directed that a certain number of reserve troops from each unit should come to Addis Ababa, because their homes were very far in the west and south of Ethiopia. The rainy season had started by the time they were ready for their journey. As rain and mud made things difficult for them, they began to arrive at Addis Ababa only by middle of Meskerem, late September, although they had set out in the month of Hamle, July. But while the Italians were offering deceptive words to the League of Nations and pretending on one hand to seek conciliation, they dispatched, on the other hand, war materials and troops. After they had completed all their preparations, they crossed the border by airplane on 21st Meskerem 1928, that is 2nd October 1935, without informing either us or the League of Nations of their decision to begin the war. They flew to Adwa and dropped bombs on the city, slaying old men and children, women and priests. They also set fire to the principal buildings. Perhaps thinking of it as a precaution, we had given orders for a Red Cross Society station to be set up at Adwa, and this too they set on fire. In the civilized world of the present time, when one state intends to wage war against another, it will not do so without notification. But Italy, without regard to her honor and good name, apart from some ephemeral advantage to her, began the war without any declaration whatsoever. It cannot be doubted that this will bring shame to her history. Apart from this, the Italian minister at Addis Ababa, Count Vinci, caused us great difficulties. If it were a government like the states of the civilized world, it would have been right for Italy to instruct her minister to notify her decision to go to war and then to recall the minister. We would then have informed all our subjects via our charge d'affaires in Italy and our consul at Asmara that they should leave Italian territory. Had Italy recalled her minister without declaring war, it would undoubtedly have been in order to stop us preparing ourselves and proclaiming mobilization. Yet we would have recognized that it was for the purpose of war. Or again, if we did not expel her minister by force, and he had been involved in some major incident, it would have been Italy's intention to have us condemned in the eyes of the world, claiming that Ethiopia had acted with violence of this kind against the Italian minister. While we had begun to follow the path of international civilization, we were convinced that it would not be proper to engage in lawless and to retrogress like Italy. We therefore notified the minister and consuls, their agents, and all their other subjects to return to their country by the nearest possible route, when no harm of any sort would befall them. Hence, it was arranged that they should leave by the route nearest to them, those in the east by way of Djibouti, those in the south via Mogadishu and Kenya, those in the west through the Sudan, and those in the north by way of Asmara. Even if we had detained as prisoners till the end of the war the subjects of a state which had unleashed the violence of war without a declaration and infringed the covenant of the League of Nations, we would not have been reckoned wrongdoers. But as we intended to seek peace, we were unwilling to do this. However, although we pursued the path of peace, the Italian minister, without taking this into account at all, refused to depart until the consuls, agents, and Italian citizens who were resident in the various provinces had all left. Thus, to make things really difficult, he summoned the Magalo agent to Addis Ababa instead of going by way of Mogadishu, which was now far from him. Worse than all this, the Italian minister abandoned his erstwhile habit of going about Addis Ababa by car and now went on horseback instead having a servant also on horseback follow him holding the Italian flag and carrying a revolver in his belt. He even started to go on ordinary roads on which no ministers of foreign countries nor even the important people of our own would venture. The soldiers who had been ordered to come for protective duties had just begun to arrive at Addis Ababa, and when they saw this minister of an enemy power going about the capital in such a procession, we heard that their blood was boiling, and they began to look upon this with hostile eyes. We were concerned, therefore, that if by any chance he got involved in an incident, everything we had hitherto patiently endured for the sake of peace would be in vain. We informed him, through an intermediary, that he was to stay quietly in one predetermined place until the agents who had been summoned arrived, and accordingly it was arranged that he should remain at a certain place. But what we had done for the sake of peace and security, they interrupted in an unfavorable sense and spread the rumor that we had detained their minister in prison. Later on, we received reliable information that the Italians had crossed the frontiers in the north and in the south and had dropped bombs on several of our cities, killing people and burning houses, as we felt that it was right for us to defend our country's independence as far as possible, although we did not even possess adequate modern equipment for defensive purposes. We directed the following proclamation of mobilization to be issued on 22nd Mescarim 1928, that is 3rd October 1935. The Lion of Judah has prevailed. Haile Selassie I, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia. People of my country Ethiopia, you know Ethiopia's ancient tradition since the days of Menelik I, and that she was well known and honored for her independence. 40 years ago today, Italy, boasting of her ability and strength, had wanted to acquire our people as slaves after destroying Ethiopia's independence. When she came into our country to fight us, our God, who does not like violence, helped us, and when he gave us victory, we did not seek to recover our land that had gone, as Italy violated the borders in the Hamasian and Somali regions and took away our patrimony. Your eye can see and your ear can hear the yoke of serfdom which our brothers who lived in those areas, in the areas she has usurped, have had to bear. While we are sad at the violence wrought against them, and while we do not seek to recover our lost lands, Italy is now thinking of imposing the yoke of bondage upon the people who live in the whole of our country. Having brought war surreptitiously to the Ogaden region, she is killing our people who do not seek conflict, and she is violating the treaty which we had concluded. We, for our part, had entered a League of Nations that was established for the sake of world peace, and therefore we informed the League with the intention that the offender be identified once the wall-wall conflict had been looked into by arbitrators according to the law. Even before the matter could be examined and adjudicated by the arbitrators, Italy had brought the war close to the frontiers of the Tigray and Ogaden. We therefore had to notify the League of Nations once more, and it issued a verdict in our favor, deciding that the matter was to be looked into by the arbitrators. When the latter had investigated the matter, they found in our favor, determining that the Ethiopian government had done no wrong and carried no responsibility for the attack which had taken place at Walwal. As all this was going on, Italy did not, for the time being, abandon the continuation of warlike activities in the direction of our borders. While Italy was reckoning to corrupt with blandishments every intention of ours to have the matter peacefully settled by arbitral verdict, she coveted our venerable country, meaning to deprive her of her liberty and to destroy it, which was well known for her antiquity and which has lived in freedom for more than 3,000 years. I would be very distressed if we were to be thought of as being defeated. Therefore, people of my country Ethiopia, help me. You have strength with your strength. You who lack strength with your sympathy. The reason for which you are to help with strength and with sympathy is that you know it to be for the sake of your religion and your freedom for your emperor, who, in mutual thought and assistance, is like a father and like a son, and for the sake of your flag, which proudly manifests independence. A nation without freedom is tantamount to a people driven from its land, being pushed like cattle by the hand of the enemy. Once that lives in bitter affliction and in humiliation as a tenant watching its inheritance in its own country in the hands of other men, which has no control over its possessions and its livelihood, not even over the soil of its grave, and which exists by an inheriting serfdom that passes on to the next generation. With other people, at least when a king or a bishop dies, being human, his descendants is substituted for him. But when a country's independence is extinguished, there is no replacement. While serfdom passes on from one generation to the next, it is an internal prisoner living with a name that does not die. And however proud Italy may be of her equipment, she too is known to share in death. 1. If you withhold from your country Ethiopia the death from cough or head cold of which you would otherwise die, refusing to resist in your district, in your patrimony, and in your home, our enemy who is coming from a distant country to attack us, and if you persist in not shedding your blood, you will be rebuked for it by your Creator and will be cursed by your offspring. Hence, without cooling your heart of accustomed valor, there emerges your decision to fight fiercely, mindful of your history that will last far into the future. 2. Let your levy of troops, without men being separated from their leader and servants from their master, be mobilized on 12th Tekemt, 23rd October, at Mikael near Desi. If on your march you touch any property inside houses or cattle and crops outside, not even grass, straw, and dung excluded, it is like killing your brother who is dying with you. You will then be punished by paying twice over for his property. 3. You, countrymen, living at the various access routes, set up a market for the army at the places where it is camping, and on the day your district governor will indicate to you, lest the soldiers campaigning for Ethiopia's liberty should experience difficulty, you will not be charged excise duty until the end of the campaign. For anything you are marketing at the military camps, I have granted you remission. 4. You, country squire, take your sons who have reached military age and set out with your district governor, while the deputy district governor gives you a stand-in who will be responsible for the protection of your land. But you who are unable to go on a military expedition owing to old age, guard your district. Let your sons set out with the district governor. 5. Sons of chiefs and soldiers, if you have reached military age and have not hitherto joined a military unit and have not entered the service of a master and remain without taking any work in the country, yet if you possess a rifle, I will assign to you ammunition and your provisions. If you do not possess a rifle, I shall let you have a rifle, ammunition, and your provisions, and then join your district governor for the military campaign. 6. All you soldiers who have come back and stay in your respective districts, having left your army unit after enlisting in it earlier on, rejoin your officers and your regiment and go on the military campaign. You servants of noblemen and of soldiers who live in the country, if you stay there because you have quarreled, make your peace and join your master in the war. But if you claim that you have been gravely wronged and therefore cannot be reconciled with your master, may you then come quickly to Addis Ababa, consigning to your master, before a war ministry judge, the equipment and any property you had received in the regiment, and then get an officer and a rifle from the war ministry in order to get back to the military operations. 7. You, who are peasants and traders, are to obey the orders which the deputy in charge of the district gives you, and to assist him in any difficulties he may encounter, having enumerated before your district governors, village chiefs, and note it down in a register any medal or rifle you possess. 8. If you are a trader, a peasant, or a priest in your own particular district, I shall pay you the cost of transportation, so bring things to me at the place of mobilization, loading up even what is usually set aside for grain tithe. 9. After you have been ordered to go to war, but are then idly missing from the campaign, and when you are seized by the local chief or by an accuser, you will have punishment inflicted upon you, your inherited land, your property, and your body. To the accuser I shall grant a third of your property. 10. If previously you have murdered someone and fear the avenger, or if you are a brigand and have set a house on fire, or have robbed a man of his money and have fled and now live in the forest or in the mountain precipices, I grant you a pardon. So enlist with your superior officer by 5th attempt, that is 16th October. When you enlist with your officer, and as you are inscribed in the district governor's register, I shall entrust you to a mediator, Ligaba, and with him or with your officer, you are to go to war. But if you fail to surrender on the day fixed for you, you will be hanged in the district where you have been apprehended. You who are the family of the deceased, I shall pay you the blood money. Hence, excuse your avenger for my sake. 11. If after the campaign proclamation has been issued, you are found committing acts of brigandage or supplying to the enemy provisions of anything at all, you will be deprived of your patrimony and property. You will be punished mercilessly and have the death penalty inflicted on you. We arranged the order of battle as is described here below. In the north, Ras Casa was to be commander-in-chief in defense against the enemy coming by way of the Tigre. Under him were Ras Seyoum Mengasha, commander of the entire Tigrayan army, Ras Mulegeta Yegazu, Ras Kabada Mengasha, Ras Emru Hayala Selassie, Ras Getachew Abeta, Dejaj Ayaleu Beru, Dejaj Menshasha Wolde, Dejaj Bayana Wademagag Nahu, Dejaj Mengesha Yelma, Betwadad Makonen Demsau, Dejaj Admasu Beru, Dejaj Abra Tadla, Dejaj Auraris Dulu, Dejaj Weldemariam Bedada, Dejaj Belaina Debalkau, the Crown Prince's Army Commander, Dejaj Wadaje Webe, Dejaj Ambachau Gasa, the Army Commander of Wag, Dejaj Hailu Kebeda, Dejaj Wanda Bawasan Kasa, Dejaj Abra Kasa, Dejaj Hailu Tasfaye, Tesahefit Izas Afawirk Weldemariam. Bejeron Lat Eyebalu Gebre, Kaznas Mach Dehna Weldemariam. Ras Casa had before the rainy season gone to his governorate of Begameder and had spent the rainy season there. We therefore transmitted to him orders to set out at once and to go to join Ras Seyoum. We directed that our war minister, Ras Mulegeta, should proceed in advance from Shoa, together with the army commanders enumerated here above. On 8 Tekemt, 19th October 1935, when he took leave of us by parading the army in front of us, we gave him, since he had to proceed with the troops, and the army mustered before us the following precise orders. It gives us pleasure watching your departure, determined to shed your blood for your country's independence and for us, your emperor, and his honor. Because it is to the servant he trusts that a master commits his property, so have we entrusted you to resist the enemy, placing your faith in God, while you take care of our army and help everyone in whatever their difficulties may be. The enemy who has now come upon us is not a new or unexpected enemy, but he is our mortal foe of old. Everything he has now achieved by virtue of our refusal to send our army preventively to the front, trusting as we did the peace-seeking efforts of the League of Nations, has been through cruelty, not even killing excluded, and he cannot be suspected of tenderness to soldiers, to the old, and to women and children, we have already heard about the early stages of his mercilessness to women and children, as death can in any event not fail to occur. It would be wrong to forget that it is of great advantage having it said that someone died shedding his blood for his country's liberty, his king's honor, and for the good name of his generation, rather that he died of a cough, a head cold, or of typhoid. If someone dies in war, he is said to be extraordinary, but to be stunned at someone's death is to debase the dignity of valor. I cannot be doubted that to a soldier, a peasant, or a traitor, his country's independence is his greatest pride. It is therefore important to convince you, to the utmost extent possible, that quarrels and deceitfulness amongst you should disappear, that love and unity should spread, and that a servant should acknowledge obedience to his master and a soldier to his officer. If the Italians are proud of their weapons against us, we on our part are proud that our greatest weapon against them is the help of God. Our flag, red, yellow, and green, and our seal with the legend, "The Lion Has Prevailed," are the symbol of our independence. Lest this symbol of our freedom should perish, it is a great honor for our good name and for our history if we die shedding our blood to the very last drop. The reason why we have told you this is that it would suit the enemy if you were to enter the war simply in order to die, without taking precautions and like a butterfly in the flame, rather than save Ethiopia from the hand of the enemy as you are fighting a war according to contemporary fashion. What exactly you should do is set out as follows. 1. When you set up tents, it is to be in caves and by trees and in a wood. If the place happens to be adjoining to these and separated in the various platoons, tents are to be set up at a distance of 30 cubits from each other. 2. When an airplane is sighted, one should leave large open roads and wide meadows and march in valleys and trenches and by zigzag routes along places which have trees and woods. 3. When an airplane comes to drop bombs, it will not suit it to do so unless it comes down to about 100 meters. Hence, when it flies low for such action, one should fire a volley with a good and very long gun and then quickly disperse. When 3 or 4 bullets have hit it, the airplane is bound to fall down. But let only those fire who have been ordered to shoot when a weapon that has been selected for such firing, for if everyone shoots who possess a gun, there is no advantage in this except to waste bullets and to disclose the men's whereabouts. 4. Lest the airplane, when rising again, should detect the whereabouts of those who are dispersed, it is well to remain cautiously scattered as long as it is still fairly close. In time of war, it suits the enemy to aim his guns at adorned shields, ornaments, silver and gold clocks, silk shirts, and all similar things. Whether one possesses a jacket or not, it is best to wear a narrow sleeve shirt with faded colors. When we return, with God's help, you can wear your gold and silver decorations then. Now it is time to go and fight. We offer you all these words of advice in the hope that no great harm should befall you through lack of caution. At the same time, we are glad to assure you that in time of war, we are ready to shed our blood in your midst for the sake of Ethiopia's freedom, as indeed we have explained to you in the speech we delivered on 11th Hamle, 18th July, 1935. Chapter 36. Our Organization of the Southern Army. We organized our Southern Army in 3 parts, right, left, and center wings. We made Dejasmach Nasibu the representative of the Duke of Harar, Commander-in-Chief of the right wing of the Southern Army. We attached to him as aides Dejasmach Ebt Amikael and Dejasmach Amde, Dejasmach Abebat Demtau, and Dejasmach Makonnen in Dalekacheu. There was also a Turkish national called General Weheb Pasha. Since he knew about Italy's war of aggression against Ethiopia, he had come to help of his own free will and without any request on our part. We gave him to Dejasmach Nasibu as advisor in any military matters. With regard to medical work, Dr. Hockman, who had been working in the American Mission Hospital established at Addis Ababa in the name of Tafari Makonnen, had given notice through the Ethiopian Red Cross Society of his wish to go down to Dagahbur to tend to the wounded. For the time being, he went on his own, but later on a Red Cross Society had been set up at Cairo, Egypt's capital, for the assistance of the Ethiopian people, and Prince Ismail Daoud, a member of the royal house, had been sent by the society together with upwards of 20 doctors and auxiliaries. He had arrived with a complete ambulance, and it was arranged that he should assist the right wing of the Southern Army with medical work. We appointed Ras Desta, commander-in-chief of the left wing of the Southern Army. As support for him, we nominated Dejasmach Gebremariam and Dejasmach Makonnen Wassane, Dejasmach Debai Welde Amanel, and Fetarari Tedasa Ganeme. For the medical work, Dr. Hockman had been sent down by the Sudan mission, but when he went to inspect the condition of a bomb and dismantle the screws, it exploded again and hit him. In consequence, he died immediately, and we had him brought by airplane to Addis Ababa, where he was buried. The valiant Grasmach Afawerk, the army officer whom we had stationed at Gorahe, had prepared trenches and had done well digging the ground to make it suitable as a firing position and for defense against bombs from airplanes. Hence, when Italian soldiers came there on two occasions, he sent them back defeated both times. And after the Italians had become convinced that they were unable to engage in an infantry battle, having closed in face to face with Grasmach Afawerk at Gorahe, they began unleashing a rain of bombs on the place, returning repeatedly by plane. On one occasion, they dropped 300 bombs there, but they did not cause much damage, apart from killing 5 men and wounding 15 who had not observed the instructions to be cautious. On Dekemt 23rd, that is November 3rd, 20 airplanes returned and dropped bombs, and while the brave Grasmach Afawerk was firing with the oil cone and taking aim to bring down a plane, a bomb splinter that had fallen by his side hit his leg and wounded him. As his bravery after being wounded inspired him further, he endured the pain of the wound and carried on his work. But after he had waited a little, he became aware that his strength was flagging and that he was unable to fire. He therefore requested to be carried off, and they took him to a place where he could rest. It was only at Dagahbur, at a distance of some 220 kilometers, that the nearest doctor was, and he was concerned that his soldiers might disperse if he were to go there. As he lay there, he notified the commander-in-chief, Dejasmach Nasibu, by radio telegram as follows: "I am severely wounded and may perhaps die. Therefore, please send an army officer quickly to Gorahe to replace me." Dejasmach Nasibu dispatched Fetarari Gwangul Kolase as commander to Gorahe. As they took Grasmach Afawerk Weldesamaet to Dagahbur for medical treatment, he died on the journey, and they buried him with honor in the church of St. George at Dagahbur. At this time, a physician of the Sudan Interior Mission had offered his help as a volunteer and went to Sidamo. But later on, the Swedish Red Cross Society had appointed Dr. Highlander and sent doctors and auxiliaries together with a fully equipped ambulance. It was arranged that they should go to the left wing of the Southern Army. To the center wing of the Southern Army, we appointed Dejasmach Bayana Mared as commander-in-chief and attached to him in support Becheron Fekre Selassie Katema, Fetarari Atnaf Saget Welde Georges, Aznamach Asefeu Welde Georges, as well as Kesnasmach Selaba and Kesnasmach Andom, who had joined us, having deserted the Italians, because they refused to fight our country together with the enemy. For medical work, however, no doctor could be found for the time being, so those Ethiopians went who had some knowledge of bandaging wounds only. Later on, it was arranged that some of the Swedish doctors who had gone to Ras Desta should be detached and proceed to Dejasmach by Anamarit. Apart from this, before the beginning of the war, very few soldiers held all the small towns which were in the districts of the right southern front, such as Dagahbur, Bulale, Sasabene, Dagahamado, Burgot, Gorahe, Haradiget, Gabredare, Fafan, Cheko, Webi Shebeli Burdade, Teferi Katama, as well as similar places on the left southern and central southern fronts. We gave orders to all the army officers who were on guard duty to stay in the positions to which they had been assigned. If the Italians attacked them, they were to resist as far as possible, but if the aggression against them became too fierce, they were to fall back. But the Italians began to fly over in their planes and to unleash a rain of bombs upon all the little towns enumerated here above. But as the soil of the Ogaden province is dusty and sandy, most of the bombs were found buried in the sand, unexploded. Thus, on one occasion, a bomb that had fallen near Dagahbur was found unexploded. The Italians again brought along airplanes in waves of 20 each time. On 24th and 25th Ekemt, 4th and 5th November 1935, and totally obliterated Gorahe with the bombs they dropped. They killed the Somalis and their animals who had come to Gorahe region to water their herds, and then entered Gorahe. Fitarari Guangul Kolase, who was Grasmach Afawerk's replacement, had not heard of the Italians' entry into Gorahe. He thus marched on with some 500 soldiers and reached a place called Hanale, to the east of Sasabene. When he heard gunfire, he ordered his men to scatter quickly and widely amidst the bushes, crevices, and grass. Having waited a little, they saw Italian soldiers arriving in lorries, followed by quite a number of tanks. They lay silently until the Italians had gone forward. Later on, however, those in the tanks alighted from their vehicle to look at an engine that had broken down, and the men in the lorries got out as well. Grangle's soldiers were watching right and left, forward and rear, and when he gave them a sign, they fired a volley and wiped out the lot. In this astonishing battle, only a few of Guangul's soldiers were killed, but Guangul himself was injured, and as his men remained there, being unable to push forward, he informed Dejasmach Nasibu of his victory. When Dejasmach Nasibu heard of their brave action, he sent two lorries and arranged for the wounded to be taken to Dagahbur for medical attention. In this victory, there were captured, in addition to some damaged machine guns, for most excellent machine guns, as well as many rifles and bullets, and they were taken to Dagahbur. After we had heard about the death of Grasmach Afawerk and the occasion by the Italians of Gorahe, news also reached us that the Italians on the northern front were pushing on forward from Adwa towards Makale, and that the governor of Makale, Dejasmach Haile Selassie Gugsa, had betrayed his mother country Ethiopia and us, his emperor, and had gone over to the Italians. In consequence, we made Desi our headquarters, since we intended to wait while finding out about the position of the armies on the northern and southern front. Before proceeding to Desi, we went down by plane to Jaca on 9th Hadar, 19th November 1935. The next day, we conferred the rank of Dejasmach upon Grasmach Afawerk, who had given his life with such valor for his country's independence and for the honor of his emperor. This was intended to be a memorial for future generations and for history. Subsequently, we bestowed the rank of officer upon several men. On the third day, we assembled the army officers in full and gave them words of advice as to how to guard against bombs from airplanes and other dangers. We then arranged for the following written advice to be distributed. Since the Italian government has for 40 years now set up out to destroy Ethiopia's freedom by aggression, your heroes who are alive now and who were present at that time, and those of you who were not at Adwa, but whose fathers had been there, they have shown their heroism by shedding their blood, and they have saved their country's freedom and their patrimony from the hands of the enemy. Now the Italian government is preaching to its people to avenge that battle which is lost 40 years ago, claiming that in Ethiopia the army was a spent force and that therefore they would fight us without difficulty. The Italian government has begun the war to make you, who did not die, share the fate of those who did, to destroy your freedom by abasing the well-known bravery of Ethiopia's sons, which is recorded in world history, to invade your patrimony and your houses, to acquire as slaves your old parents, to make exiles of your sons, and to reckon Ethiopia's heroes as if they did not exist, and to attack with us, with its army, in the north and in the south. All the governments of the world, being aware of Italy's violent onslaught upon Ethiopia, are our supporters. While Italy believes that Ethiopia's heroes have ceased to exist and persist in discounting those who do, the important thing is that it is your duty to revive your valor by defeating the hostile attack launched against your generation and against Ethiopia, and by victoriously driving out from our land our enemies who have taken it by violence. Man has not been created to be everlasting. His end is death, which severs him from this world. This death may come early or late, but for all mankind it is inescapable. It is man's name alone that remains as a memorial until the world, which appears to hover beyond the grave, passes altogether. When this our enemy fought us at Adwa 40 years ago, Ethiopia's brave men beat him victoriously. Hence their names will remain unforgotten, mentioned forever, not only yours, who are alive, but even theirs, who were lost there. It is the main source of pride for the present generation. Again, even for a young man, as the enemy attacks him, robbing him of his country and his patrimony, and carrying his family into exile, it is the death that comes upon him in battle, which is indeed his greatest wish and source of pride. Even the hen will struggle to save her chicks from the vulture. This being so, do recognize that it is proper for a man to fight with the enemy, however many thousands of times the latter may surpass him in knowledge and strength. Since death is thus in the end ineluctable for mankind, how great will be your honor if you lose your life fighting the invading enemy to establish an inextinguishable reputation, to prevent aged parents, wife and children being exiled, and while today they live in dignity in their freedom, free country of Ethiopia, if that liberty were to be destroyed, to prevent them sinking into humiliation, and this their dignity being lost, your glorious name will endure, being praised by your children and your families, and being recalled by world history. We have been aware for some time of our enemy's intentions to carry through this plan of aggression, and we, your emperor, ruling you in time of peace, have told you of our resolve to shed our blood, being amidst you in time of war. Thus, we are now with you. Since you know about the multitude of different instruments of war the Italians have been accumulating, they cannot cause you much injury. The things which is called airplane is intended to cause shock by the noise of the bombs it drops and to weaken the heart, but other useful things it does not do. While present-day modes of warfare may cause you much damage, it is necessary to follow the advice we have given you through your respective officers so as to enable you to attack your enemy. In order to defend your country's independence, we shall not deprive you of our support to lightening your burdens in terms of money and provisions in all your difficulties which you may encounter in this place at which you are stationed. And now, lest any kind of trouble should befall the kinsmen and families of the heroes who have laid down their lives while carrying out their duty for the honor of their country and their families, we shall protect them as emperor and father. We have therefore instructed our military representatives that their names should come before us in writing through their respective commanding officers. We are forever with you until our life expires. 10th Hidar 1928, that's to say 20th November 1935. As regards the deployment of the army, if they went down to the central Ogaden, the countryside there would be one of severe desert conditions without sufficient water and food for the army or grass and fodder for the animals. We, therefore, gave orders that they should remain reconnoitering in the area from Jijiga to Dagahbur, and that if the Italian army crossed the desert and made an approach towards them, they should then open hostilities. They should further let us know about everything that occurs at any time by sending messages to wherever our headquarters will be. Subsequently, we set out by automobile from Jijiga to Harar. At Harar, we arranged a launch party for our retinue and then went down to Diradawa. On the morrow, 11th Hidar, that is 21st November 1935, we returned to Addis Ababa by air. Chapter 37, about Dedje's match Haile Selassie Gugsa's treachery. After the Italians had entered Adwa by dropping bombs from airplanes rather than by valiant battle, they disclosed in their daily communiques that many Ethiopian nobles had deserted the emperor and had gone over to them. This news was not the whole truth. According to the custom of our country of Ethiopia, when nobles who have been army officers or provincial governors relinquish their appointments, being no longer able to carry out the work owing to advanced age or ill health, or when some of them are dismissed from their offices owing to some offense having been proved against them, there are many of them who remain on their inherited property, engaged in agriculture or trade, or being otherwise maintained. When they live in such circumstances, they do not cease to be referred to by their former rank. The Italians, however, induced these nobles who had retired from government service to go over to them, by force or by intimidation, and began to reveal over the radio that a certain Dejasmach or Fitaurari or Kaznasmach had deserted his emperor and gone over to them. "The country accepts us. The people like us," they claimed. But it was not possible to deny and to claim as mendacious the news of the betrayal of Dejasmach Haile Selassie Gugsa of the nobles of the Tigray. Dejasmach Haile Selassie is a son of the Tigrayan prince Razgugsa Araya. Being the son of a prince, he had married our daughter Zenebe Werk. But when only about a year had passed since marrying her, by misfortune both his wife and his father had died in quick succession to each other, and he had thus fallen into deep grief. But although his wife and his father had died, we had no thought of lowering him in rank, and in fact gave him his father's governorate of Enderta, Agame, Bora, and Selewa, as well as authority over Eda Mahone and the two Aulalo regions. We also directed that he should reside in the chief city of Makele. His father Razgugsa and Rasiyum had lived in mutual envy and distrust about the headship of the Tigray, and now, since he was still young, two small districts from the extensive governorate which his father had held were added to Rasiyum's domain. He took this as a pretext and progressively made plan his hostility towards Rasiyum, meaning to carry on the quarrel that had been started by his father. The Italians had been laying it down in their preparatory planning that they might be able to take Ethiopia without recourse to military force, by inciting the important men to mutual enmity and by inducing them to desert the emperor. Thus, when they heard about the quarrel that had started between Dejasmach Haile Selassie and Rasiyum, they began exchanging messages with the former. "Some people gave us this news, but we discounted the reports directed against him and did not suspect that a man who claimed to be a descendant of Emperor Johannes would betray Ethiopia. Whatever the circumstances, for Emperor Johannes had been an opponent of the Italians. Lest this calumny that had been rumored against him should be revealed, he used to write to us as follows: If by any chance the Italians should invade us by military force, I shall resist them to the utmost in my province of Agame, until I die." He sent further messages to say, "I have exchanged messages with the soldiers of Hamasian and have arranged that they should desert and come over to us." Later he wrote, "Those soldiers with whom I have communicated have come over to me." A second piece of evidence which he offered for his loyalty was concerning his accusation against Dejasmach Kebeda Aragel, his father's brother. The substance of this accusation was as follows: "Dejasmach Kebeda Arago is not loyal to our government. The fact which proves this is his constant exchange of correspondence with the Italians. Having discovered a letter by which he entered into such communication, I have been able to lay my hands on it, Further, he sent his two sons to Asmara and arranged that they should receive their education from the Italians. Therefore, please send me a plane to me, for it would be best if he were to come to your majesty. If not, he will cause me difficulties by making propaganda for the Italians here. The letter which I have obtained, I had to purchase for money from the hands of one of his intimates, with the intention of ascertaining the truth of this matter. We told him to send the letter to us. After he had done so, we had Decismach Cabeda brought to Addis Ababa by plane. By his acting in this manner, it seemed to us that all the suspicions against Decismach Haile Selassie were untrue, and we neglected the matter. But when we were told about the Italians entering Adwa and Agame, we also heard that he had confiscated the weapons of the men from Hamasian who had come over to our side and had arrested them. Subsequently, we dispatched to Makale, ostensibly as support for Decismach Haile Selassie, Decismach Haile Cabeda as commander, Decismach Bogala Berru, Decismach Desta Goangul, Decismach Alamayahu Desta, Decismach Tafarai Waldu, Decismach Balai Maru, Decismach Bent Awel Detekle, Decismach Ejegu Kebeda, Fet Aurari Mesfen Zalake, Fet Aurarit Abaha Tekle. They set up camp near Makele and transmitted to us by telegram the following message. To Haile Selassie I, Emperor of Ethiopia. Decismach Haile Selassie, whom you trusted, has betrayed his mother Ethiopia and his father the emperor, and has made it known by proclamation that he has gone over to the Italians. The army of Wag alone, fighting at Makele, will not be able to repulse the Italian invader who claims that he will take the whole of Ethiopia. It would therefore be well if troops, armed as much as possible, were to come to us. Many of Haile Selassie Gupta's officers left him at once, declaring, for the sake of our faith and our history, we shall not fight our emperor jointly with the Italians and deliver Ethiopia into the hands of foreigners. By their coming to us, we were finally convinced of the truth of his treachery. A servant of his who had deserted him and had loyally come over to us because Decismach Haile Selassie had betrayed his country and surrendered to the Italians, gave us the following report. When my master Decismach Haile Selassie went to Asmara for medical treatment or in order to go by boat to Addis Ababa, the Italians used to tell him, "We shall wage war against Ethiopia. After destroying Rasiyum, we shall place you on your father's throne and make you the king of the whole of Tigray." They also used to show him the multitude of their cannons, their machine guns, and their airplanes, as well as the modern make of their rifles. Thus, on one hand, they would give him hope of obtaining the whole Tigray, and, on the other, would make him afraid, in view of his tender age, when he observed the mass of Italian military equipment. The fact which establishes the truth of this, together with what we have said above, is that when Decismach Haile Selassie defected and got mixed up with the Italians, General De Bono issued a proclamation in his favor, declaring, by the command of His Majesty King Victor and the Duce, El Duce, Monsieur Mussolini, we have assigned to you the whole of Tigray up to the Ala water and have nominated Urras. However, after their designs had been accomplished, they did not even give him Makele, his father's seat, let alone the whole of Tigray. After the Italians had accomplished the desertion of Decismach Haile Selassie, they believed that other great officers would desert and go over to them, and that on these grounds the hearts of our soldiers would be panic-stricken. But in fact, there was no one, officers or men, who was stunned or made afraid by his treachery, apart from detesting and hating him, declaring, "This is the brother of Judas Iscariot." After he had announced his desertion, our officers were approaching Makele, and while his chiefs and servants were getting in touch with our officers, they determined to try to catch him. But when he heard this, he left Makele at 7 o'clock, that is to say, at 1 a.m., during the night of 30th Meskerem, that is to say, 11th October 1935, together only with up to 50 of his retainers, and joined up with the Italians, having gone by way of Edege Hamus. those men from the Hamathian who had deserted from the Italians and whom he had detained in prison at Makkele got out of prison as soon as he had escaped and joined up with our men. After he had made common cause with the Italians, he remained until the end of the war, in fear of his own servants and countrymen, going about the country, at times to Makkele, another time to Agame or Edege, Hamus, and again to Adwa, taking extreme precautions and guarding himself like a murderer. But in not a single place did he join battle with our soldiers and fight. We do not think that foreign historians, let alone natives of Ethiopia, will ever forget the story of his treachery. It must not be thought that he who betrays his mother will benefit his nurse. Chapter 38. We go to Desi. After we had made the dispositions for the northern and southern armies, it was our duty to defend our country's independence in the midst of our troops. We therefore directed that our guard of honor, the Imperial Guard, should depart in advance under their commanding officer, Kaznazmach Makuria Batirgu, as well as the army group called Mahal Safari under the command of Legaba Tesau. We ourselves set out from Addis Abeba on 18th Hedar 1928, which is to say 28th November 1935, and traveled to Desi. Our main purpose was to stay at Desi as rear guard for the advance corps until the remote border regions were mobilized on the strength of the mobilization decree we had previously issued. With us were the following army commanders: Fetaura Ribeiro Huelte Gabriel, Tejas Machale Selassie Abaina, Tejasmach Huelte Emanuel Hawas, Tejasmach Adafersel Yenadu, Tejasmach Winderat Defabacheu, Kaznazmach Balhu Dagafu, Kaznazmach Tekle Marcos Huelte Gabriel. After we had reached Desi, the Italians thought of lulling us into a false sense of security, and therefore waited for about a week before coming over in their planes. Even prior to setting out from Addis Ababa, we had instructed our armies to do everything necessary in the way of precautions against airplanes, and they had consequently begun to observe these precautionary measures by digging the ground in their various camps and by constructing shelters. Later on Friday morning, 26th Hedar, that is to say 6th December, 21 airplanes suddenly arrived and began to rain bombs on us. We at once transmitted orders that our troops should quickly enter their shelter, for we were anxious lest they be exterminated for lack of defense. We ourselves got hold of an Oerlikon anti-aircraft gun and began to fire. But as the planes were flying very high, it was impossible to hit any on that day. Considering the size and quantity of the bombs they dropped, it was scarcely believable that any human being survived at Desi, but the majority of the bombs they dropped failed to explode, and therefore the number of those who died was only about 20, and of those who were injured about 100. Further, some 50 thatched houses were set on fire, but on this day they did not cause much other damage. Moreover, the bombs which fell upon various churches, apart from just rolling down, did very little damage, and all the people were amazed. Subsequently, the planes began to come, at times in a regular turn, at other times again only on every third day. On one occasion, however, on 7th, that is to say 16th January 1936, one large plane turned up, and as we were watching and expecting it to drop bombs, at first smoke was seen to emanate from it, and subsequently the plane caught fire. Those inside it came down by parachute, but as they landed on a precipice, they were all found to be dead. The airplane itself was burnt out. While we were at Desi, the British minister at Addis Ababa, Sir Sidney Barton, and the French minister, M. Bodard, presented to our foreign minister, Blat Anguet Aherui, the proposals which Laval and Haore had put forward for the purpose of conciliation, declaring, "We have been instructed by our governments to show and to present these proposals to the Ethiopian government. If the Ethiopian government so desires, it may accept them. But this is not a matter of compulsion." Blat Anguet Aherui transmitted them to us by telegram on the same day. The plan by Mr. Jorge and M. Laval was as follows. A. Tigre, the region of eastern Tigre, is to be ceded to Italy. In the south, it is to be delimited approximately by the Geba River. In the west, by a line running from north to south and passing between Aksum, to be assigned to Ethiopia, and Adwa, to go to the Italian side. B. As regards the rectification of the border between Dankali country and Eritrea, to be defined by a line which leaves Ausa and southern Eritrean parts to Ethiopia, to provide for necessary access to the sea. C. Rectification of the border between Ogaden and Italian Somaliland, starting from the triangle at which the frontiers of the three countries, Ethiopia, Kenya, and Italian Somaliland, meet. The new Ethiopian-Italian frontier is to be as follows. In the main, it is to take a northeasterly direction, cutting the Webi Shebeli and passing towards Idole, leaving Goraje to the east and Werendab to the west, and joining the border of British Somaliland at a meeting point on the 45th meridian. The rights which the British Somaliland tribes possess to use the pastures and waters within the territories to be assigned to Italy under this delimitation are to be safeguarded. D. Ethiopia will obtain an outlet to the sea with full rights of sovereignty. This access to the sea shall be arranged at a place to which Italy will agree, on the Assab coast, together with territory that affords access to the port and goes down in a narrow strip adjacent to the frontier of French Somaliland. The United Kingdom and French governments will endeavor to obtain a pledge regarding Ethiopia's fulfillment of her obligations in the matter of the traffic of slaves and arms incumbent upon them, the applicable in the territory which Ethiopia is to acquire. The limits of this zone were to be thus. In the east, the rectified frontier between Ethiopia and Italian Somaliland. In the north, the 8th parallel. In the west, the 45th meridian. In the south, the border between Ethiopia and Kenya. Within the territory here delimited, which would have severed the greater part of Ethiopia, Italy would obtain exclusive economic rights, and the administration in that territory would be undertaken by a company of some other kind or some other kind of organization. To this company would be assigned the rights of ownership over unoccupied territories, subject to the rights of native and foreign citizens there, the monopoly of exploiting minerals, forests, and kindred matters. This organization would be obliged to contribute aid to the country's economic structure. From its income, it would have to give a proportion to the welfare of the native population in a manner which is essentially of a social character. The control of the Ethiopian administration within the enclosed zone would be exercised under the emperor's sovereignty in accordance with the scheme of the service of assistance granted by the League of Nations. The emperor had already previously accepted this as extending over the whole Abyssinian territory. Within these services, however, and under the direct control exercised by a principal advisor, Italy would possess a preponderant influence. The said principal advisor may possess Italian nationality and will be an assistant as regards the affairs in question to the chief advisor selected by the League of Nations to help the emperor. The chief advisor is not to be subject of any of the powers bordering on Ethiopia. It is incumbent upon the employees of the scheme of assistance in the capital city as well as throughout the reserved zone to regard it as essential that the life of Italian subjects and the free development of their initiatives be safeguarded. The United Kingdom and French governments will willingly endeavor to ensure that this organization, whose terms of reference are to be established by the League of Nations, will protect Italian interest in this region in full. After we had examined these proposals of Mr. Hoare and M. Laval, we were resolved not to surrender to Italy of our own free will, our country which had remained free for over 3,000 years, unless the League of Nations compelled us to accept such a judgment. We therefore had the following protest communicated to the League of Nations through our minister in Paris. Is it in conformity with the covenant that the government which is in breach of the covenant should be requested by the League? Please accept, together with executive control, the major part of the attacked party's territory, as well as the remaining part, under cover of the League of Nations. While it is the unshakable truth that it is the enemy's wish to destroy completely the party that has been attacked, as the General Council well knows, is the country which has fulfilled the character and which is the victim of wrongdoing to be asked by the League to abandon her defense against a powerful enemy who is opposed to her right of freedom and self-government and, for the sake of the world peace, to agree to accept her attacker? Is the attacked country to abandon hope of finding a savior and to nurse the fear of betrayal by the League, thinking that it will really desert us? This matter, which is the main problem for future international relations among peoples, whatever their appearance, their race, or their power may be, ought it not, first of all, to come up before the League and to be examined openly with full freedom and before the eyes of the whole world? Chapter 39. While at Desi we hear of the dismissal of General De Bono and the appointment of Marshal Badoglio. While our headquarters was still at Desi, we heard of the dismissal of General De Bono, who had been Italian Commander-in-Chief, and of the appointment of Marshal Badoglio. The reason was said to be, as we were told by some of the journalists who were with us at Desi, that General De Bono had not wished Italy to start the war, but rather to adopt a defensive position. And when the order to start the war reached him, he did indeed start it, but he did not do so gladly, and is said to have neglected the conduct of hostilities. What proves this to be true is the account which appears in the book written by General De Bono after his return home upon dismissal from his war command. He there says, "When I asked how I was to act, since the emperor was said to be engaged in prayer and fasting, being unwilling to be the initiator of the war, orders reached me to the effect that if the Negus did not wish to start the war, I was to launch the attack and to fight him. I therefore began the war." Secondly, General De Bono states that, since he did not intend to open hostilities at once, he reported that he did not have enough money to begin the campaign. He received the answer that the necessary money and troops would be dispatched to him. Since Mussolini signed the preface to the book which General De Bono wrote about the war, one cannot deny the account of the Italian side by arguing that it is all lies. Furthermore, according to what some people told us, General De Bono held the view that he could beat the Abyssinians by the accustomed means of warfare, i.e., fighting them with cannons, machine guns, and rifles, and that it would destroy the history and the honor of the fascists if they were to gain victory by fighting with smoke gas and with mustard poison. Peoples who possessed no defense against this, and it would therefore be better for the Italians not to do so. It was said that the reason for his dismissal was that he expressed these views. Later on, all communications with our northern armies by telephone and radio were disrupted by bombs, and we, therefore, lacked news of the situation of Ras Casa and Ras Ayoun on the Tambien front, of Ras Emru and Dejasmanj Ayalu on the Shire front, and of Ras Mulugeta on the Alege front. For this reason, we decided to push forward, but as we have repeatedly shown before, we found ourselves in great difficulty over the matter of weapons, since, on one hand, we wished to maintain world peace, and, on the other, we were putting our trust in the covenant of the League of Nations. In the third place, we did not have enough money to purchase modern war equipment, and when we asked for a loan, it was withheld from us. When we made requests to purchase arms with the little money obtained through support from our own people, all the governments within the League of Nations refused us on the grounds that they were not permitted to sell war material from their countries to Ethiopia and Italy. This was a matter of much astonishment to all who heard of it. Italy possessed factories in which almost all the various arms which she desired could be made, but Ethiopia did not have arms factories. It was therefore not fair for these countries to argue that neither Ethiopia nor Italy, being rivals, could buy war equipment from them. Moreover, prior to the war, we had made an agreement in Paris with Britain, France, and Italy to purchase arms for the maintenance of internal security. For this reason, there was some arms which had already been purchased, and we directed that they should now be brought to us in our present troubles. When they reached Djibouti, the governor of French Somaliland prohibited their being loaded on the train. We asked him to make inquiries in Paris on our behalf, but because of his delaying tactics, claiming that he had received no reply from his government, we were convinced that they would not get here in time for our present difficulties. We thus abandoned waiting for their arrival and proceeded to Koram, where we had to be. But later on, just before the war ended, permission was given to load the arms on the train when half the transport was still at Dire Dawa and the other half had reached Addis Ababa. It naturally fell into the hands of the Italians and thus ceased to be of any service to us. Chapter 40. We hear of the rout of the army of Ras Desta's front. Our son-in-law, Ras Desta Demto, whom we had appointed commander of the left wing southern army, had come close towards Dolo, which is situated on the border of Italian Somaliland. When General Graziani, commander-in-chief of Italian Somaliland, heard of Ras Desta's approach to the frontier, he turned towards Ras Desta the army, tanks, and airplanes which he had stationed in the Ogaden and launched an attack against him with all his strength. Ras Desta was at a place suitable for bomb attacks, but unsuitable for infantry. His army was, therefore, unable to withstand the onslaught of tanks and bombs and was defeated. Furthermore, another reason why Ras Desta's troops were so stunned was this. When the Swedish Red Cross doctors, stationed according to regulations, a long distance from the war front, were treating the injured, these troops saw the Italians, clearly aware where the wounded were being looked after, coming in their airplanes and dropping bombs on them, burning their tents, medicines, and all their medical equipment, including even their food supplies. Of the doctors themselves, one was killed there. The leader of the Swedish medical team, Dr. Highlander, was severely wounded. The wounded patients who were actually under treatment were hit by bombs while being cared for in that tent, and many of them died. When it was learnt that Dr. Highlander had been injured, the Swedish physician at the Bethsaida Hospital at Addis Ababa, Dr. Hanner, went there by plane and brought him back. He treated him and nursed him back to health. The remaining doctors, as on one hand a hostile attack had been perpetrated against them, and on the other, their medicines and medical equipment had been set on fire, were compelled to go back to Addis Ababa in order to prepare fresh medicines, medical instruments, tents, and food supplies. So they had to leave all the wounded and had to return, because time was needed to make all these preparations until they were ready to return. The Italians, on their part, were hurrying on with the war and were exterminating soldiers and peasants with bombs and poison gas. The time was thus propitious for them to push forward. When Ras Desta realized that the Italians had seized the road which he had built for cars and lorries, he took the troops who had escaped death and, marching fast by routes cutting through the desert, reached Nagale, lest the Italians should find all the food and other provisions which he had collected there. He caused them to be set on fire and then left for Wadera. After the Italians had set on fire the village and church of Nagale with incendiary bombs, they proceeded towards Ras Desta's position at Wadera and attacked there. But as the place was wooded and hence not suitable for bombing, there was nothing they could do there. But they discovered a Swedish Red Cross lorry standing at some place there, filled it up with their own ammunition, and then began spreading the mendacious rumor all over the world that they had found a Red Cross lorry loaded with ammunition after Rastesta had resisted the enemy by moving about the Sidamo and Bale provinces, remaining there for a year or so, he entered Arusi province. As General Graziani heard of this, he surrounded him with a large army and fought a big battle in Arusi and Marrakech. Rastesta was captured in this engagement, and on 16th Yekatit 1929, that is to say 23rd February 1937, he was killed by the Italians for the liberty of his country and the honor of his emperor. As to the army commanders who were with him and those attached to Decesmach and Gebremariam, the Italians themselves reported that they died doing their duty as officers. Chapter 41. We issue a proclamation for further mobilization. We had heard that, on the war front in Sidamo, the enemy had increased his pressure and, aided by tanks, was beginning to make progress with his invasion of the country in the Nagale area. Therefore, in order to have additional troops progressively organized, we issued the following proclamation to our people from our Desi headquarters. The Lion of Judah has prevailed, Haile Selassie I, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia. People of our country of Ethiopia, Italy has incited a quarrel, broken a contract, violated frontiers, and, while disregarding completely treaties which she herself had voluntarily signed and which the League of Nations had approved, initiated destruction by battering peaceful cities, by annihilating children, women, and the aged, by burning churches, by indiscriminately killing with bombs members of the International Red Cross who are helping Ethiopians and Italians without distinction, and by dropping smoke gas, which is prohibited by law. And as if this were not enough, you have yourselves seen and heard her attempts in every way possible to drop down, fighting by distributing mendacious pamphlets, words of lies and deceit to shatter the peace in the country and to stir up trouble among ourselves. And there is no one who is not sad and resentful about this matter, among foreigners even, let alone our own people. When an enemy soldier wanted to take and rape a woman living in a town undefended by our Tigrayan army, she pierced his heart with his own dagger and disarmed him. When she came to us, the Ethiopian people, men and women alike, were known to be burning with rage at the violence committed by Italy. Old men and women, you who are able to go to war, help me with sympathy and with your money as you have done up to now. While we resist our aggressive and violent enemy, we find in the attack that has come upon us, and even in death, an inestimable recompense in the scales of history and before God. Our God has proved that he is with us by the strength which he has manifested in our army, which has so far gone out to war. Our enemies, while unsuccessfully by force of rifles alone, have not managed to shake the heart or change the mind of our brave troops, even when those enemies attempted it by intimidating us with concealed weapons and by dropping gas smoke. Up to now, our army has resisted our enemy with strength and has pushed forward. As we told you when the war began, with the Ethiopian people united, we set out determined to defend ourselves until the last drop of blood is shed and to share the trials in the midst of our army. Of this, not only the Ethiopian people, but the whole world is convinced. Now then, you who are natives of Ethiopia, I will give provisions to you who have none, and I will give arms to you who have none. Hence, stay mustered and registered on the front of each province, and remain prepared to go to war under the army commander I will announce to you. 12th, 1928, that is to say, 21st January 1936. We likewise transmitted the following advice and order, so that our Sidamo army, which had been attacked and hurt by the enemy's force, should be strengthened, and that everyone who was not yet a soldier should help. As in this world sadness and joy occur alternately, man feels strong one day and weak on another. You who have up to now gone down into the desert. Rastesta had told me at the time of your resistance to attack, sickness, and bombs. You who are doing your duty, having survived not only for the sake of your own district, but for the rest of the country, is the enemy to enter Sidamo as if there was no men left there. Now, for the future, not only soldiers, but also you, young men, who have reached arms-bearing age, be mobilized and help as soon as Ras Desta notifies you. 1928, that is to say, 28th January 1936. We directed that this pronouncement be transmitted to our army in the Bala region. Chapter 42, Our March from Desi to Korram. As we set out from Desi, traveling towards Korram, bombs were raining down upon us throughout the journey. Moreover, to travel by night was very difficult for us, as the road went up and down, and there was no moonlight. Before our troops set out from Addis Ababa, we had made arrangements to have instructions printed and distributed as regards precautions, so far as these were possible, against bomb attacks, since they traveled by scattering and hiding in the woods. In accordance with the precautionary instructions, the bomb attacks could not hit them. When the Italians became aware of this, they began to drop bombs on the wooded parts and on all sites offering shelter. Nevertheless, even so, they were unable to find our troops and to inflict much harm. For this reason, they changed their tactics and started bombing rural areas and grazing cattle, and thus broke the heart of people in the country. Furthermore, the Italians were aware that the Ethiopian people were firm in their Christianity, and so, as every Sunday, priests and monks, men and women, old and young, flocked to church to hear Holy Mass, they lay in wait for them and set out to exterminate them with bombs. For this reason, many churches were set on fire. Marshal Badoglio knew that the Ethiopian people, being very religious, felt deep grief at the burning of their churches, and so, lest the Italians' heathen work should be revealed, he began scattering pamphlets by airplane to say, "Take courage and do not grieve, for I shall rebuild the churches which have been destroyed and burnt down." Apart from killing Christian people and from setting fire to Christian churches, their burning of ancient Ge'ez manuscripts, which, written on parchment, had long been preserved in many churches and represented sources of knowledge and wisdom, caused much distress not only to Ethiopian people, but to scholars all over the world who were researching into this kind of knowledge and learning. Italy, while claiming to be a Christian state, had her armies set fire to churches and manuscripts, and maybe did not realize that in later times this would debase her honor and extinguish her history. In difficulties of this kind, we passed the town of Waldia in the district of Yaju and reached Korram. When the Italians realized, however, that on the journey from Desi to Korram they had not inflicted much damage on us with the bombs they had dropped from airplanes, they began to drop in casks the poison gas called Yeparit. Some casks exceeded 1 meter in height, and their width was large. As they fell, they would explode like a bomb, and the poison would be splashed, killing everybody nearby. It is very distressing that the Italians should come with such new-fashioned cowardly weapons in order to destroy completely the brave Ethiopian people who had no defense against weapons of this kind. Although they may destroy the Ethiopian army with this instrument of poison, yet when it is reported in future history that they wiped out with poison a defenseless people, it is not to be doubted that this will forever be a burden of shame and humiliation for fascist Italy. Subsequently, they installed in their planes a mechanism which sprinkled poison like rain and proceeded to pouring it down like rain upon our troops and peasants, upon cattle and waters, grass and foliage, and upon the soil. As the precipitation was extraordinarily fine, it was not clearly visible to the eye. We had heard that a poison spray of this kind might be used to kill disease microbes if a tree or plant disease had infected some tree or plant, but we had not suspected that it would be employed against troops and peasants. But the Italian airplanes which were spreading this poisonous mist in order to destroy the Ethiopian people as well as animals living on mountains and in fields, were going to and fro from morning till evening and set out to exterminate man and beast. The countryside as a whole seemed as if it had been consumed by fire. It was impossible to find a pure breeze in the air, and men and animals began to die, being unable to breathe. Anyone fleeing from there and taking shelter under trees and crevices, thinking to be safe there, was unable to escape and thus expired there. The whole place being nothing but corpses, the stench brought us worse troubles, as there were so many who died. It was impossible to bury the corpses. While we were at Koram, a messenger arrived giving us accurate information about Ras Mulugeta's situation. We felt great sadness at what he reported to us. Since Ras Mulugeta was our war minister, he had marched to Makele with an army of some 50,000 and was firmly resolved to oust the Italians from the city of Makele. But the Italians knew about his plan from their spies and, therefore, overtook him at the front, while Ras Mulugeta was still at Amma Aradom. Also, they had given arms and money to the Raya and to other Galas in the area and had thus caused them to desert us. They directed them to surround Ras Mulugeta from the rear and to deny him supplies of provisions. Ras Mulugeta was well known for his probity and valor. When he joined battle on Wednesday 4th, Yekatit, that is to say 12th February 1936, he fought hard for 3 whole days, and although he could resist the enemy's infantry, it was not possible to put up a defense against bombing and machine gunning from the air. He was, therefore, forced to withdraw to the rear in order to fight from another and improved position. But as his troops were dispersed at various places and the Raya Galas had surrounded him at the rear, it was just not feasible for him to wage another battle. So he began marching to join us on 18th Yekatit, that's to say 26th February, at a place called Agio. A bullet struck him accidentally, and he died. The few servants who were with him buried him, and we learnt about it when they arrived. The army commander at Walega, Bitwadit Makonnen Demtsaw, had heard that Ras Mulugeta was surrounded in front and in the rear and rushed to his aid. He came into contact with the Italian army and fought with bravery, forcing them to abandon 2 fortified emplacements at a place called Kaihata. On the second day of the battle, he was injured by a bomb and died on 8th of Yekatit, that is to say 16th February. We heard that he had no longer managed to come to Ras Mulugeta's aid. For all these reasons, we went forward and, being ourselves commander-in-chief, we resolved to fight and to lead others in battle. Chapter 43. Things go well with our armies in Shire and Tambien. It was with Rasayun's troops that the Italian military forces first came into hostile contact. Rasayun's soldiers were about 30,000. These were not, however, concentrated in one place only, but were fighting dispersed over a number of separate positions. We had transmitted orders to Rasayun not to engage in face-to-face fighting, but to remain well to the rear. The reason was to prevent any harm befalling him if he were to join battle while on his own before Ras Kasa, commander of the Northern Army, reached him. A second argument was to induce the Italian troops to move towards the center and thus to afford an opportunity of surrounding them. After Rasayun had been waiting, in accordance with the instructions he had received, for some 2 months, withdrawn towards the rear and in defensive positions, at the end of Hedar, early December 1935, Ras Kasa caught up with him, and while they were waiting, Rasayun, being stationed on the left wing, Dejaj Ayaleu at the front, and Ras Kasa in the rear, the governor of Gojam, Ras Emru, joined them with an army of 10,000 men. It had been arranged that he should look out for any enemy forces coming from the direction of Shire. Of course, by proceeding in this manner, we had not been thinking that the Italians would exterminate our army by smoke gas and Yeparite poison, but rather that they would join battle by frontal attacks and infantry action with machine guns and rifles. The intention was, in fact, to enable our army, which was positioned on the right and left in the front and rear, to surround the enemy and to cut them off as soon as they entered into the center of the trap. We were further contemplating that the army in Ras Casa sector was perhaps too small and vulnerable, and we therefore issued orders that from the armies, which were with our war minister, Ras Mulegueta, the groups under the following officers should detach and go to Ras Casa sector. Dejesmach Meshasha Welde, Dejesmach Mengesha Yelma, Dejesmach Bayana Wademagag Nahu, Vetaura Rizaudu Abakoran. On the basis of this prearranged plan, things had to turn out favorably for our troops in Shire and Tambien. Among these officers, Dejesmach Bayana Wademagag Nahu, having fought with bravery, was killed. At that sector, it was the Eritrean soldiers who fought hard against our army, but Italian blackshirts were few in number. But the Italian blackshirts were positioned so far to the rear that there was great difficulty finding them. When they saw our army come upon them face to face with swords drawn, they fled before all else. Thus, in general, they would not join battle without preparing a route of escape. Of those of our soldiers who were holding defensive positions in the Shire and Tambien regions, there were only about 10% who had Mauser rifles, but 90% had rifles more than 40 years old, such as Fusil Grass, Schneider, and similarly antiquated weapons. They did not possess more than 125 machine guns. As to cannons, they did not have a single one, apart from the captured from the enemy. And that captured gun was not working at all, as it was found that some parts of it were missing. The lead of the Fusil Grass bullet is black and soft, and therefore, when it rests again against a bone, it expands and rubs against it. If it penetrates through flesh, there is a big and extensive wound where the lead emerges from the flesh. For this reason, when the Italians noticed this, they announced that they were hitting them with dum-dum bullets at Abi Adi and on the Erba Waine. Our army, under the command of Ras Casa, fought hard and was victorious. In the Shira area, the army which had been sent under the command of Ras Emru also fought valiantly and captured more than 100 machine guns and a great deal of military supplies. But our soldiers, according to their long-established custom, would throw up their rifles and, unless they engaged in a sword battle at close quarters and face to face, they would not reckon it valorous to kill by shooting with rifles from a distance. Hence, it is true that by such actions they suffered heavy casualties. Apart from the battles at Abi Adi and Erba Waine, there was a large-scale engagement at Shum Aure. At the time of this battle, the Italians emerged from their fortified positions, and the engagement became a face-to-face fight. There were no planes in the air, and it was a battle of true heroism. The only difference between our soldiers and the Italians was that our men possessed antiquated weapons only, while the Italians had modern arms. Nevertheless, our soldiers, with their customary agility, entered into the midst of the battle, leaping forward like leopards, while the Italian soldiers began to flee, leaving behind their machine guns, rifles, and ammunition, as well as their telephone and radio equipment. Thus, the hearts of our troops were increasingly fortified. To estimate the quantity of captured weapons and equipment, it is sufficient to say only that it took many hundreds of soldiers for whole days to go to and fro between the arena of the battle and their encampments. After our soldiers had brought in the arms and equipment, diarrhea spread in their camps and caused them a good deal of harm, so that, in fact, the suspicion was aroused that perhaps the defeated and fleeing Italians might have placed some poison upon their equipment. Although the Italians were superior to us in modern arms, our soldiers had the advantage in terms of courage. There is therefore no doubt that the Italians suffered heavy casualties at that time, while our soldiers, who had won the battles in the Tambien and Shire regions, were fighting with obsolete rifles like the Fusel Grass. They yet managed to capture more than 300 machine guns and many cannons and tanks. There were very few in our army who knew the instrument of war called tank. When they set out from Addis Ababa and we gave them written advice about the precautions against tank attacks, there were some who said, "What is a tank?" Subsequently, however, when they had observed three or four times the manner of their operation on the battlefield, they got used to them and followed the precautionary counsel. Thus, they suffered no damage at all from the tanks. Similarly, they would remain hidden in crevices and bushes until the tank had passed. Then they would follow and, like a leopard, would leap, climbing on top of it, and kill the crew by shooting at the various holes. At times, on account of the heat, the Italians would step out of the tanks and sit under the trees. Our men would then emerge from their hiding places and kill the enemy soldiers and capture the tanks. On Dejach Ayaleu's front, a man called Fetarari Shefara captured 5 tanks in a single day. As things had gone favorably for our army fighting in the Tambien and Shire area during Tahas and Ter, December and January, they had been very close to forcing the Italians to abandon Aksum and Adwa and to getting to Makele and cutting it off. Ras Emru in the Shire region was watching very carefully to the east and south of Aksum. He gave his soldiers provisions as he had been ordered to do before the opportunity had passed. He then calmed their hearts and began the battle. The Italian army on his front was estimated to number some 25,000. On 11th Yekatit, that is to say 19th February 1936, he detached a part of his army and dispatched it towards the Mereb. When they reached the meeting point of the Asmara and Adwa roads, the Italians, who were in the fortress of Rama, shone a light on them. They at once began shooting, killing 5 men and wounding a few. The Italians, however, announced that they had killed 45 and wounded more than 100. But Ras Emru's soldiers approached with a mixture of caution and daring and launched an attack upon the enemy. The Italians at Rama, apart only from those killed and injured, fled in haste and escaped. What was found there included officers' uniforms and rifles, many machine guns, together with a great deal of ammunition as well as provisions lasting for many days. On the morrow, they counted up to 400 Italian bodies who had been killed, but as they were concerned that Italian soldiers might come back and launch an attack upon them, they left the place and returned to Shire. Ras Emru informed us of this by telegram, and we directed that it should be issued as a communique. Afterwards, however, the Italians had the road leading from Adwa to Asmara guarded very carefully, and Ras Emru's troops had thus no opportunity of waging a major battle, apart from inflicting some damage by occasional minor incursions. When the Italians realized the position and strength of Ras Emru, they detached a contingent from their army at Aksum and directed them to go to Salak Lake to build fortifications, while Ras Emru on his part began taking precautions by having shelters dug in which his soldiers could be protected from bombs. Later on, the Italians clashed with Ras Emru in the neighborhood of Salak Lake, and throughout the entire day there raged a fierce battle. But the Italians possessed guns that could strike from a great distance, and so they fired on our soldiers from far away. On top of this, they dropped bombs on them from planes and sprayed them with mustard poison, so that Ras Emru was obliged to draw back with his army. And again on 2nd Megabit, that is to say 11th March, the Italians followed up their attack and, after another severe battle had been fought, as usual, many airplanes arrived whipping out the Ethiopian forces by spraying mustard and yeparic poison, so that Ras Emru, being almost on his own, had to withdraw to the rear. Furthermore, the Italians had begun to send out week by week a very large number of planes and to set on fire with incendiary bombs provincial towns such as Debat and the Simeon, Gondar in Begamedir, and Debre Marcos in Gojam. When the soldiers from these regions who were taking part in the war heard about this, they panicked and felt unable to stay on the battlefield and so started to return home little by little. Nevertheless, Ras Emru had remained offering resistance until he had heard about the military situation on Rakasa's front in Tambien, on Ras Mulugeta's front at Amba, Aradom, and Alage, and on our front at Mechu. But after he had heard about this, he returned to Gojam with those of his soldiers who had survived the bombs, gas, and mustard poison. When Dejasmanch Ayaleu heard of the Italians entering his province, his governorate of Simeon, he went to the city of Debre Tabor in Begamedir. The Red Cross doctors stationed on the north front between Koram and Lake Ashange were working with all possible care and strength. Dr. Dasios, whom the Ethiopian National Red Cross Society had sent, was never parted from us. However, from Koram onwards, as far as Mechu, there was no doctor apart from Dr. Malaku Bayan, who traveled with us as our own personal physician. In the neighborhood of Koram and Ashange, the doctors whom the British Red Cross Society had sent assisted us with much care while observing Red Cross regulations. We shall never forget this. They had set up their camp at a great distance from the army positions and had spread out very widely on the ground the Red Cross sign as well as the British flag. They had also sewn them on their tents so that the Italian airplanes should see them from far away and recognize that it was a Red Cross camp. But when the Italians in their airplanes saw this Red Cross sign, they argued that there would be no one to question them if they violated Red Cross Society rules and regulations. They therefore dropped bombs upon them with audacity and, breaking their entire medical equipment, made it into a heap of old iron. They made the tents look like old moth-eaten rags. They injured and the sick to whom the doctors were ministering remained buried there when the ground on which they were lying was turned upside down by the bombs. We do not suppose that there are recorded in the annals of any war waged in our contemporary civilization any similar acts of cruelty. We trust that all who read these lines will not fail to observe when they see such lawless actions that in Italy the work of civilization is reckoned to be worthless. We must not recoil from repeating this over and over again. When setting fire to places where the sick and injured are lying in the hope of receiving medical treatment and of recovering there, and in addition to finishing off the injured by crushing their bones anew, the Italians have committed the following deeds of violence, which are bound to humiliate and shame them exceedingly in front of all decent men. After the Italians had obliterated with their bombs the English Red Cross mission, the doctors sought and discovered a cave in the neighborhood of Koram, which seemed to them a strong shelter which the Italians would not be able to reach. They therefore brought all the sick and wounded into that cave and made them lie down there. But the Italian airplanes sniffed out this cave like a hunting dog and followed along there. It became therefore impossible to bring further injured people to the cave, or indeed to take out those who had entered. The wounded, as well as those who carried them, had the greatest difficulty in passing in and out. On these grounds, the British Red Cross doctors believed that it would be preferable to transport the injured by loading them onto mules, which would walk in scattered groups rather than conveying them by lorries, which are very clearly visible. It was thus necessary for Dr. Melli, their leader, to go back to Addis Ababa to purchase mules and additional medical equipment. On top of this, the doctors also had to take care of their own lives and those of their assistants. Hence, our people, who had hoped that the Red Cross doctors would treat them and look after them when they saw the kind of attack that was descending upon the doctors, as well as such acts of cruelty, which should never be carried out against human beings, being perpetuated against them, felt sure that it was with the devil that they were fighting. Thus, their lack of hope and their despair exceeded all bounds.